get like 5 seconds of that.
You're not.
Through another and the continuing set of lectures from the Center for InfoSec Studies and Research. This is a group in the computer science department here. We're really pleased to have with us from, I was going to try and say it, but the CNRS from France. Yves Deswarch. I've known Yves for a number of years, and we've got several program committees together and so on, and he volunteered to come down here to do a talk for us. And he's going to talk today on the privacy-enhanced internet and some of the technologies that can be used to achieve that.
First, I must apologize because English is not my mother tongue, and my French accent is terrific, so you will have to make some effort to understand what I say. Second, I'm suffering from jet lag, 10 hour jet lag I traveled yesterday. So if I'm sleeping during the talk, please wake me up. Yes, privacy enhanced internet. Well, the summary of the talk will be first to talk of what you are meaning by privacy. I say you because privacy is an English word. You cannot translate it easily in French. So I'll try to give some meaning to this word, and some legislation. We have in Europe at least strong regulations and strong legislation governing privacy. And we will see that these laws are not sufficient. So we have to add something. And we take an example based on e-commerce, and then I will take this example to look more into detail on which kind of privacy-enhancing technologies can be used in the internet, what we call PETs, with this meaning. So first, some definition of privacy. By privacy, I think that you mean something which is linked to intimacy. That means some data or some things that you don't want to share with everybody. You want to share only with friends or with people that you know. Intimate with. So there is the notion of protection of a private domain of personal data. And in this talk, I will mainly discuss about personal data because that's the only way that I can explain privacy on computers, on communications, on networks, and so on. But the idea is to go further than that, to deal with your intimacy. We have a formal or informal definition of privacy in the common criteria. That's the first time in the common criteria that these applications, these security requirements were applied to privacy. In the TCSEC or the ITSEC in Europe, there was no notion of requirements for privacy in security. In the common criteria, for the first time, you have some requirements for privacy. In fact, there is one functional class with four families, and the word defining privacy in common criteria is to have some protection against discovery and misuse of identity by other users. Only identity, that's not enough, in my view. You know, there are other points concerning privacy that have to be taken into account. But at least, that's something. And in the common criteria, there are four families for this functional class. Anonymity, which means that the other users cannot know the identity of a user who is running some operation. Pseudonymity, that's the same thing. The other users cannot know the identity of the user who is doing something, except that this guy is still accountable for his acts. That means that in some way, it should be some way to gain the identity to punish somebody misusing this anonymity, pseudonymity. With anonymity, there is no way to retrieve the real identity. So, in most cases, you need pseudonymity rather than anonymity. Unlinkability, it should ensure that users or subjects cannot determine whether or not the same user has made several operations or not. And unobservability means that other users cannot know even if an operation is run or not. So that means that nothing is visible. That's four levels which are not necessarily directly linked from one to the other. except for pseudonymity and anonymity. That's quite evident. But for the two others, there is no direct relationship with the links, except that, of course, an observability, if it was perfect, if a perfect unobservability was implemented, then nobody knows nothing. Examples of legislation, at least in Europe, or more precisely even in France. We have a law from 1978, which is quite old when you are thinking about computers law, about protection of nominative data. That's a word which is used, in fact, in the law, informatique et liberté. So it has to do with informatics and liberties. The main point on the law is that nobody is allowed to store personal data or nominative data into files, computer files, without first declaring that they are using these files with this kind of information and what kind of processing is run on this file. That's one thing which is important. The other most important thing is that some information are forbidden. That means nobody is allowed to store on the computer file information about the race of a person, the religion, political or union, membership or opinions. This is forbidden. Nobody is allowed to do that. With some exceptions, of course. For instance, the churches are allowed to register their membership. And probably there is some relationship between the membership of a church and some religious opinion. But that's an exception. What I should say is that it's a very strong law, but not very expensive to apply. In fact, it's just a declaration. When you are creating a file, you decide at some time to create a file. For instance, a mailing list. Then you have just to declare with a form, to fill a form, to say that you are using a list of persons with names, addresses, phone numbers, I don't know. And that's all. No race, no religion. And then you declare that, that's all. You will just say, we are using this file for mailing purpose. You have nothing more to do that. That's it. But very few people are doing that. For instance, I asked recently to the agency which is responsible for this in France, what the assessment of how many websites in France, e-commerce website or other websites, were applying the law. So how many of these were declaring the files, nominative data files that they were holding? They say, well, one third. That means two web servers in France out of three are illegal with respect to this law. Well, because nobody is able to know if there is a file, if there is a nominative data file somewhere. You have to declare them. There is no way for the commission to search your website to know if such a file exists. Of course, they know that if you are doing e-commerce, there must be somewhere a nominative data file because you have customers and you have a list of customers, somewhere there are. But two out of three don't declare them. So much French people are outlawed. That's not new. That's for France, but there are similar laws in most European countries. In fact, there are even European laws, which are the European Convention, which is very vague and not applicable in the law, the national laws, and directives. Directives are some kinds of European laws. That means that when they are decided at the European level, every member state must implement them in their national law. So there are two different directives, are more than that. The two main for privacy. The first one is what I call free movement, because the idea was, again, to facilitate the competition between service providers or goods providers, merchants, and so on, at the European level, so that no nation, no member state, could rely on a national law protecting personal data to prevent commerce through Europe. So That means that this directive was meant as a minimum law to be applied everywhere to protect data so that no member state could implement a stronger law which would prevent the commerce at the open level. That's important because that's not really protecting that much. So in this law directive, only the minimal requirements, I would say, in my view, of privacy are implemented. That means that you cannot sell nominative data file to another enterprise or company. You cannot transmit personal data file to member states who do not apply these laws, or non-member states, in example, the US, can transmit personal data from the EU to US because the US do not apply that law. So there is a safe harbor convention between Europe and US to solve this problem. That means if a country, a company in US is accepting to apply the same kind of rules within the company concerning private data, personal data, then commerce of personal data can be established between Europe and US companies. That's for the free movement. For telecoms, that's both for the providers or operators of telecommunications and networks, which kind of information they can record on communications, and what are considered as private and cannot be recorded. For instance, actually in France currently, ISPs have to record all technical connections on the internet, but only the technical part, not the content. So the content is considered as private, but the connection is considered as mandatory information which has to be recorded by the ISP so that the law enforcement agencies can look at who has established a connection to something. Not the content of the connection, not the content of the communication, but the connection itself. But when you are browsing through the web, connecting to one IP address, to one web server, is already some content, because this web server is dealing with some information which you could consider as private. So I would say that there are also some risks related to privacy, and the law is imposing restrictions to your privacy, or to mine. Each member state in Europe has at least one data protection agency. That means one organization, which is non-governmental organization usually, which is responsible to check if the law is applied and to enforce these privacy laws in each member state. There are other protections on the private data. For instance, in France, there are laws for professional secrets. For instance, security administrator or network administrator, even if he can access to some information, let's say the content of the mail, it's possible for security administrator to access it. Then even if he has to access it for some reason, for instance, to debug some connection which is failing, he is responsible for this secret. That means he must consider that the content he has access to is a secret that he cannot disclose, of course. He is not allowed to disclose that. And that's the same for the correspondence secret, which is already a code which was imposed to the post office and the mail delivery companies. Then it's also applied to electronic communications, of course. Well, we have lots of laws, not very efficient. Why? Well, first, because the internet is spanning over international borders without consideration for jurisdiction, for laws, and so on. So what is a law which is enforced somewhere is not necessarily enforced elsewhere. So for a single transaction, you cannot even know if your transaction is abiding to the law or not. Second, maybe more important from the commercial or economic point of view, to to implement or to enforce this law, these laws. It's only done on a voluntary basis. That means, and usually they don't, as I said, two-thirds of the web servers in France do not obey the law. Because it's costly, it's very, it is difficult to implement all the aspects of the law. And this cost that you are spending on this, you will not receive any return on that. So it's an investment for which you will never get back, or not easily. Yes, question?
Is there any effort underway to get 100% compliance of France?
Yeah, in fact, these data protection agencies are receiving complaints because some companies are not obeying the law. There are other aspects of the law. For instance, any citizen, any individual can ask this agency if his name, his nominative data are stored on some service or some server somewhere. And the agency is supposed to reply to such request. In fact, they cannot do that because they are not numerous enough to be able to do that. They can only say that, yes, I know that one company has information which could have information on you, which is very difficult on the other side. So they say to the individual, you should contact first the company that you are looking at, rather than contact me. But anyway, the law is that. And you are right, complaints. They can complain that the information that they have on your personal data are wrong, and you have the right to correct them. Or you can ask to be put out of the fact. Again, you must know first that you are in the fact. So in fact, the only complaints that are effective at this agency, at least in France, are those that come from inside the company. For instance, trade union will say that the human resource service is recording information which is forbidden by the law. Or they are creating a new file they didn't declare. In that case, the agency can make an inquiry to check if that's true or not and ask for penalties against the company.
If I make an inquiry, is the company required by law to tell me the truth about storing information?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's not, they are required by the law. Not sure.
So I take it not enough French citizens are doing this, right? If a lot of French people did this, then they would report these companies to the...
It could be possible, for instance, for consumer organizations to do that. But I don't have examples of that has been done at a large scale. That maybe could be done for small companies, but not as far as I know for large scale. Again, a very large company which is directly involved with customers will try to obey the law because the penalties could be very high. So they will spend money not to be sued.
Is that because there's no strong consumers union in France?
There are strong consumers union, but again, to know the information is difficult. So it's better if you have the information from the inside rather than from outside. But for instance, to take an example, very often credit companies are requesting information. They should not. And for that, they're sending you a form. And if in the form there is some information which they should not have, then you can ask the agency to make an inquiry and then sue them. But again, I'm not a lawyer, so I did not want to discuss about that. It's just an example to say that there are laws, but it's not sufficient to have laws to be implemented. Last point is that you have to trade off between internet security and user privacy. And again, the trend is going bad away from the privacy. If you are implementing more security, that means that you will have strong authentication of users, you will have registration and recording of all connections from users, persons, not only from IP address, not only from machines, but also from users. And then you will have very much difficulty to hide what you are doing on the internet. And that's privacy problem. Of course, not everybody is a criminal. But everybody will have to implement this strong authentication and will have their information recorded. Even if it's just a normal citizen use of the internet. So we will need more technologies to implement privacy properties rather than just rely on the law. The laws are not enough. And a good principle to start is to apply what is done by the internet people. Need to know principle. That means you should know only the information that you need. No more than that. And that's applied as well to privacy as for usually military secrets. What is a translation for privacy is that personal data should be available only to those who need them to accomplish a given task and only for the task duration. The second point is the most difficult. Again, when an information has been disclosed, how can you keep it back or erase it? Not easy. But at least it's a good principle. And that should apply on the internet like in the real world. In the real world, you can buy a daily newspaper by just a coin. It's completely private, even if it's an automatic machine. So they don't have the relationship. So nobody is able to record that you buy this newspaper rather than that one. Democrat newspapers or the relative. On the internet, you should do the same. But on the internet, it's quite easy to record that you are looking at these Republican rather than these Democrat newspapers and to report that, which would be forbidden in French. So there are limits, of course. The limits is that you need to provide law enforcement agencies means to work and to be efficient. For instance, to fight against money laundering, terrorism, and so on. And you also need to have means to resolve disputes when a customer and a merchant do not agree of what happens on a given transaction. They must prove to a judge that some part of the transaction that started but was not finished, and then to have some way to say who is responsible for this failure. So that means that this need to know principle should be amended in such a way that some personal data must be made available under judicial control. So that means again pseudonymity rather than anonymity. But the rule would be the same. That means except for these two cases which are related to some judge somewhere, then there should be anonymous or pseudonymous. Just only the data that are needed, really needed, should be disclosed. Example, e-commerce transaction. That's quite evident. Again, a given e-commerce transaction is just not between one customer and one merchant. There are other parties which are involved, and usually lots of parties that you don't even know. The customer, the merchant, the delivery company, the banks, of the merchant or the customer, the credit card company, ISPs, phone operators, and so on. There are lots of people who are involved in a single transaction. But if you are looking at what is the information, personal data, which are needed by each party in this transaction, in fact, you should disclose much less information than you do now. For instance, the merchant doesn't need to know the customer's identity, usually. The only thing which is important for the merchant is to get his money. That means he must be ensured that the money order is correct, but not valid, but not who is doing what. The delivery company doesn't need to know the customer's identity, only the destination, the delivery address, not the customer, the buyer address. It's not necessarily the same. Doesn't need to know which object, which goods have been purchased, only the characteristics, physical characteristics of the goods, the weight, for instance. The banks, the same for the banks. The customer's bank doesn't need to know the merchant. Doesn't need only to know the reference of the account, the bank account. Same for the merchant banking server. The ISP do not need to know anything except the connections that have to be established. That's all. So, in fact, you should implement things in such a way that only the needed information is transmitted and not more. So on internet, we are looking mostly only four kinds of pets of privacy enhancement technologies. To protect the IP address, to protect the location of the user, to give anonymous access to some services, and to preserve privacy while making some authorization implementation. That's the four things that you should provide at the internet level. That doesn't mean that it provides everything for the privacy. For instance, I do not consider it what has to be done at the server level, on the customer system, or at the enterprise level, where lots of personal data, for instance, the employees' files are stored. And you have to know how to manage this data. And that's not part of my talk. It could be another interesting talk, but not mine. So these are those that I will look at. IP address. In fact, an IP address can be, in most cases I would say, a nominative data. This is an example of a mail that I sent from one of my accounts to another account. I have at another ISP. In this mail, you have my IP address, the IP address of my machine. In fact, it's a fixed address. It's always the same address for my machine. There is all, even the name, I can't begin. There is even the name of the machine, which is TSFYD. TSF is the name of the research group I'm part of, and YD are my initials. So even the DNS service know who I am and where I am and which machine I have. So that's on every mail which is sent from a machine. So it's part of the header of every mail. That means that my IP address is known by a lot of people. All those to which I've sent the mail, but even much more than that. And that means that every time that from this machine I'm connected to a web server, they know which IP address is connected there, and they can relay that to my personal data, for instance, my name. So in that case, my IP address is nominative data, is personal data, it should not be disclosed like that. Now it's no more the case. I've been changed the data. So it's not, but it's not very strong. Just an example. So how to protect this IP address? The first way is to have dynamic IP address, for instance, DHCP, PPP, NAT, network address translation, are services which can easily generate dynamic address, which means that you cannot rely anymore an address and a person. There is also other ways, such as anonymous, what are called anonymous routers, which means that they are able to make translations of addresses in some way. The idea was first proposed by David Chung, by what he called mixed networks, which has been implemented in several ways, such as onion routing or cards and so on. There are diverse variants of the mixed ID. Just 2 minutes to say words about mix. As you see here, if a user from a given address X wants to send a message M to a receiver at the address Y, he will first cipher the message and not the address, of course. The IP address of Y is the address, yes, in the message, but you will use some key that is known at least by Y to encrypt the message and some nonce, that means a random value for this part of the message. But if it was just sending from X to Y directly, then somebody on the web, on the internet, on the link, would be able to know that there is a communication between X and Y. So to prevent that, the communication is using mixes, such as the first one will be considered as the destination of the message. So there will be first connection from X to mix 2 with the address, key address of mix 2, but with enciphering the other message. That means the complete message to Y is first enciphered by the key of mix 2 with some nouns, and again the same message as was sent to Y. And this is not sufficient because it could be either that mix 2 is a bad guy that you cannot trust, or that somebody is able to check what is entering mix 2 and out, so that to have to be able to recompose the connection between X and Y. So you can use other mixes and then encapsulate the message by some other envelope, which is able to hide from some observer on the network that there is a connection between different emitter and receiver. The example given on this network from the sender to the server, so from the client to the server if you want, you can have on the mesh network that represents more or less internet, you can have different uses of mixes. For instance, using the first one as the first destination, and then this one as the second one, the third, and there, and so on. So the mix topology doesn't need to correspond to the routing topology at all, of course. If it was corresponding, you would have lose. You would lose the privacy of the communication. You can. It's not very efficient from the communication on the internet, of course, point of view. The throughput is bad, but well, your information, your IP address is correctly hidden if at least one mix is trustworthy. How does it work? Well, I will not spend too much time on that. Each mix receives messages. Each message is first checked for a duplicate. That means if two messages, identical messages, are received, quite probably the second one is a replay of the first one, which is used by a bad guy, by an attacker, to try to crack the IP addresses. So to check some relationship with one message on input and the message going output of the mix node. So if there is a duplicate, then you drop it. If it's not a duplicate, then you decipher it with the local key, you put it in a buffer to mix it with some other messages. If there is no enough messages, then you add some padding to create false messages, fake messages. You mix them in different order so that somebody who is looking at the input and at the output at the same time cannot easily make the correspondence between the message in input and output. Okay? That was the first, the IP protection, the IP address protection. Second point is the location. There's a question to
me. How does that prevent spammers from sending me all kinds of stuff?
Well, spammers will add some. It depends.
Okay.
Well, there are some implementation of these IDs in which both the emitter and the transmitters are anonymous. That means that the emitter doesn't know the destination. He wants to have a service given by one server among some group of servers. He doesn't know who. He knows that somebody is able to solve this problem. And then, in that case, you don't know precisely which is the why when you are requesting a service. So there is no direct relationship. If you send a spam to this guy, you don't know which guy you will attack. If it's just for the for the fun of making noise on the network and dropping the throughput and so on, that will work. So it's not rather spamming, it's rather denial of service. But for spamming, it doesn't bring anything new, usually. That means the same address that you know, you can spam it if you want or not. It's more that I would say that since the system is very inefficient, it's a very high cost on the internet, each message is traveling a lot in the internet, then it's, if you are using that, you can easily create denial of service. More easily, but not more easily spam. It's not, nothing to do with spam. Location protection. Today, most usually, one IP address corresponds to one location, more or less precise. Because the routing is topological, that means we are using in the internet the geographic distribution of IP address to know how to route messages. And currently, many service providers, some kind of service providers, know their customer locations. ISPs, of course, but also cellular phone operators can know where are every user at some point of the day. There are other services which are currently deployed, such as fleet management for trucks and so on, navigation helps for individuals and so on. So, all these service providers know their users and know where they are. In most cases, it's not very useful. Location is a personal data which is sensitive in most cases. You should not be able to be just followed by everybody everywhere where you are. Your location is a private data. It will still be worse tomorrow. Tomorrow is IPv6. For instance, when we say that we will have a very large space of IP address, then every device, every pad, every tie, every pen, will have an IP address. That's what we call request computing in English, ambient intelligence. That's the jargon used by the European Commission to say the same. Ambient intelligence. That means every device will have an IP address, every person will own several devices, each of these devices will be located somewhere by other devices belonging to other people. That's what it's called ad hoc networks, so the networks will be established when you are in the proximity of other devices, which will identify each other, route messages for each other, and so on. So there will be not only very easy to follow where are the people, but a lot of people that you don't care of will know where you are. You want it or not, they know. Well, that's an important problem. And more work, more research has to be done on these problems. For instance, one way to do that is, again, to use dynamic IP address, and that means that with this large address space, you can generate dynamic IP address for each session. You don't need to keep the same always, even if that's what the people want usually. And to have some session identity, that means to have virtual identity just valid for one session, but after that, you forget. But there's still work to do. Another point, third point, access to service, anonymous access to services. Well, that's, I would say, the most developed and currently available, the PETs on the internet. You have lots of what is called anonymity proxies, such as for web servers. If you want to reach some web server that you don't trust to record or not personal data about you, you can use a relay by some anonymity proxy where you will connect first and which will relay your request to this destination web server and will filter in all personal data as it can, such as IP address, of course, so There are two TCP IP connections rather than one. And also filtering the headers of messages so that it's not easy for the destination web server to know who is making a request. That's quite available for web, for FTP, of course, also, it's still easier. For email, but email in one direction. That means anonymous mail. You can send an email, but you cannot receive a reply from this mail with using anonymity proxies. For all internet services, you can't imagine to create anonymity proxies. So they are at the application level. A web proxy for a web server. A FTP proxy for a FTP server. And so. A little more than that are pseudonymity servers, which are also available more or less freely on the internet. Some of these services are, you have to pay for them, but some are free. Email. The difference between anonymity proxy and pseudonymity server is that in that case, you give to the user a pseudonym, the server, the pseudonymity server, is giving to the user a pseudonym which is used to reply to him. So there is a two-way connection for anonymity. Question.
Which of these need to be trusted?
Well, again, you need to trust each one that you that you use if you are using one. But you can use several in chain and establish a chain of trust, like for the mixes. In that case, you need to trust at least one among all these pseudonymity servers that you are using for pseudonymity mails, for example. But it's more costly, it's more difficult to manage and so on. So you have a trade-off between the confidence that you have in the service and the efficiency or the speed or the cost when you involve more than one server in a chain. Yeah?
I would suggest that it's probably not as difficult to accomplish as we might imagine.
It's not very difficult.
But the worldwide banking system has been working pretty well for a long time, and oftentimes it's just an account ID.
That's the second point that I would say, is quite usually multiple identities are provided by ISP. If you ask your ISP, you will have several mailboxes with different names that you can use for different use. That means that you have multiple virtual identities. Nobody knows that there are two identities are the same person, except your ISP, of course. But you can have accounts on several ISPs and so on. You can have more than that. And again, on this page, this already exists and we don't need to provide something more. We have already solutions for that. Another example is multiple virtual identities, such as the ones which are proposed by the Liberty Alliance. I don't know if you know that. It's a group of companies such as IBM, such as, I don't remember all of them, which are against the Microsoft Passport approach. In Microsoft Passport, the idea is to have a single identity somewhere at Microsoft, that you trust enough for that, and this identity will be used by lots of merchants and services, and you don't have to register to each of them. You have a single sign-on on Microsoft Password, and that gives you accesses to all your virtual identities that you have on all these services. Well, if you trust Microsoft, that's good. Liberty Alliance is the contrary for the same. Depends on where you look at it. You will have an account at Liberty Island, which will link all your virtual identities together. For instance, if you have a virtual identity for your frequent flyer miles at some air transport company, and then at a car rental company, you can have a single sign-on at Liberty Island, and they will have the link between these two identities, air transport company and rental car company. So it's easier for the user to have a single sign-on again, but you keep all your virtual identities. That means if you want to have to address directly Earth or directly Continental, you will have your identities at consumer and at health. But if you want to have a single connection, you can also. So I would say that it's more liberty there than there. Yes.
Timely update. IBM is not in the alliance, or specifically, and Microsoft and IBM have teamed up together to create an anti-Liberty alliance called CS/I.
Okay.
So now we've got three.
Yeah, at least. Maybe more than that. So just on the principles that I was looking at. I don't remember who are members. There are a lot of members in the JTI. Last point, last class of pets is about authorization. I've already said that client server, in my example of e-commerce, I was considering lots of parties in a single e-commerce transaction. In fact, today the implementation of this single transaction is based on client-server scheme or paradigm. But every access on the internet is based on client-server paradigm, in which the server grants or denies the client with privileges according to the claim identity it knows of the client. This claim identity can be verified by authentication means or not. But the main point is that the server is responsible to give or to deny the privileges. So it needs to know the identity of the user, because that's according to this identity that we do authorization or not. And more than that, the server needs to collect as much as possible information on the transaction in case of dispute, so that the normal functioning of a server is to collect information, personal data, related to one transaction, to one identity of a client, and to collect them naturally, I would say. So they need, in that case, to collect information. So need to know principle, in that case, applied to that case, would require to collect a lot of personal data. And this information can be issued just for client profiling, or direct marketing, spamming, blackmailing, and things like that. Again, what is a legitimate transaction today may be forbidden by the law tomorrow. And then if the merchant of this legal transaction publish or blackmail you to publish this information, it's very important money information which could be misused, I would say. So there is one proposal, which is the P3P, to adapt this view of the world, so that to try to implement within the client-server paradigm the need-to-know principle. In fact, P3P means Platform for Privacy Preference Project. It's proposed by the World Huawei Consortium for an automatic negotiation on privacy policy. That means that the web server publishes a privacy policy saying what it does with the information that it collects. And the browser, the user, is configured in such a way to negotiate with this server which personal data can be transmitted or not. Well, that's a proposal which is not bad, but very limited. In most cases, the policy will say, I need this information, and I will do nothing with that, you can trust me. Of course. And then the browser will say, well, I need to make this transaction, so I will accept to transmit all this data. But, well, it's a progress, but not very sufficient. Anyway, this paradigm, client-server paradigm, is outdated. You have more than two parties, usually. These parties have different and opposing interests, so they should not trust each other. They're mutually suspicious from each other. And this scheme is also privacy proposing. So you have to imagine other things. Since I am late, I will go further to present what is done by certificates today. But I would say that you should prove that you are authorized to do something without disclosing your identity. One way to do that is to have multiple certificates for all the applications that you need. For instance, subscription cards, association cards, even driving license, voter registration card, should not be disclosed with your identity. You should just present your driver license to prove that you have a driving license. So you don't have to prove what is your address, what is your birth date, and so on. So have a different certificate for all these applications. Another way, which is quite interesting, but which is based on complex crypto, is to use restricted certificate. Well, the first one is not based on complex crypto, it's spooky, where you have attribute certificate and authorization certificate, which can be used for this purpose. But with some linkability, which is not very easy to solve. More interesting is the other one, partial revelation of certified identity, which means that with one certificate given by one authority, you can present only not the full certificate, but only one binary reply to a request. For instance, are you more than 18? And you will have a certified answer, a bit yes, no. And this will be signed by the certification authority. So with the same certificate, you can prove one bit of information without disclosing more than that. But prove the one bit of information. That was a good paper, and there are other works on it. But there are lots of problems. Linkability, if you have a single public key, such as or you have multiple public keys, but how do you manage all those public keys? It's difficult, it's long, it's complex. Management of certificated keys, that's not easy. Authentication, it's another point. Evidence collection. How do you collect evidence if you need to use this kind of skills? How do you revoke certificates? That's all difficult problems. Another approach is what we proposed in a MAFTIA project. MAFTIA is a European project for tolerance of accidental and malicious faults on internet application. In that case, you have an authorization server, which is a distributed system, a distributed server, distributed among different sites, some of which can be failing or intruded by bad guys, or even managed by bad administrators, bad guys. As long as together, this server gives you the good authorization performance. How does it work? Well, if a user requests for instance, a global distributed application such as tweet this file F3 on this printer P4, which are distributed among different hosts, it will ask for an authorization, a composite operation authorization request to the authorization server. The authorization server will decide locally and then exchange this information to create or not a permission to do this operation, but in fact, enough permissions for running the whole application. That means that with these permissions, the user will be able to run all the methods and exchanges needed for printing the file to the printer, so that the user can call the print spooler to print, to ask the file server to read the file F3 and then print it to the printer. What is interesting there is that you don't ask for each access to the authorization server, you ask only for one global composite operation. The second point is that you can delegate rights that you don't own. For instance, the user doesn't need to be able to be authorized to read the file F3 to print it. In most cases, such as Unix, for instance, if you want to delegate the read file right to an object, you need first to own this right. So the user will need to own the read write file to be able to delegate it to another object. And to be able to read a file is a higher privilege than to print it. You can make copies and distribute it. So you can implement also the least privilege principle, not only the need to know privilege, the need to know principle. Well, that's all I wanted to say. I will give a short bibliography if you want. and then give a copy of the slides for use later. Thank you.
We have time for one or two questions, and these might be available afterwards for more questions if you have any. Sure.
The last protocol was similar to Kerberos. It does similar sort of authorization.
So
it was the last protocol you had up there was similar functionality to Kerberos.
No, Kerberos is the first version of Kerberos is for authentication. It's not on small chain access control. Kerberos would give you a right for access to a server, and the server will decide to give you or not the right, according to the identity which is provided by Kerberos. So it's privacy intrusive. There, the identity is never disclosed. You have just a proof which is traveling with the invocation message. We have no relationship with the user who has requested the right. Just to prove that the operation must be realized.
Yes? Have you looked at Seven Brands work with anonymous certificates?
I don't remember, but maybe you can give me the reference.
Yes. Any other questions for now? Okay, well, thank you, Ian. Appreciate it.